A few years ago, they just sort of turned up. They came without warning, kind of out of nowhere. At first, no one was really sure where they came from. Terms like safe space, microaggression, trigger warnings. This was a new language of liberal snowflakes, the risk-averse, safety-obsessed so-called I-generation, kids born after 1995, the ones probably cowering in a campus corner somewhere, desperately searching for a safe space. Or maybe they were the ones who protested at UC Berkeley last year when the right-wing flamethrower and desperately seeking FaceTime, Milo Yiannopoulos, was invited to speak to a conservative student group. Yiannopoulos was forced to cancel his speech at Berkeley. Yes, that Berkeley, birthplace of the free speech movement. These days, it seems the I disapprove of what you say, but I will defend to the death your right to say it, is more like I'll run away in tears until you stop. A recent study found this I generation obsessed with safety. They drink less, smoke less, become sexually active later, which I guess in many ways is a good thing, but they don't want to leave home and they want to be kept away from people they disagree with. In other words, they want to be protected from the ideas they don't like because they'll get upset. And now a new book takes a closer look at how this happened and maybe how we can fix it. The Coddling of the American Mind, How Good Intentions and Bad Ideas Are Setting Up a Generation for Failure. And one of the authors, Greg Lukianoff, joins us now from New York. So, Greg, first of all, I would like to thank you for dressing up and thank you for being with us.
Thanks for having me.
Great. Okay, the premise here is that the I generation kids born after 1995, are significantly different than millennials born between 82 and 1994. Is it just the social media here? Is that the big game changer?
The social media makes a big difference. It doesn't explain everything that's going on when you look at the data, but there's definitely a correlation. So we went looking for what happened around 2013 because I defend free speech on campuses, and students had always been the best people on speech on campus for freedom of speech. But then suddenly, like you said, we had microaggressions and disinvitations and all this stuff happened seemingly overnight. And as me and my co-author looked into it, we actually found some really disturbing findings about how different the internet generation born after 1995 is, particularly when it comes to issues as serious as mental health.
And what we were hearing, though, in what your book puts out and some of the other studies out there, is that they just don't want to hear stuff which upsets them. And you argue that that's just not a really good place to be for mental health.
Well, you know, we should be clear that most students are okay. But unfortunately, what we've done, and we kind of look at this through the lens of cognitive behavioral therapy, we've taught a habit of sort of catastrophizing. We've created lots of obstacles to actually talking with people who don't share your point of view. And we look at trends, including political polarization. And unfortunately, we think we've let all of these things add up to a situation in which we're going deeper and deeper into our echo chambers instead of actually trying to talk across lines of difference.
See, I thought we were already doing that. That's what our generation was doing. You know, you have the conservatives watch Fox News. The liberals go away. They watch MSNBC. You know, everyone has their own newspapers. No one talks to anybody. No one even lives together anymore.
Right.
Democrats live with Democrats. Republicans live with Republicans.
Right down to the city block, by the way.
Absolutely. And there was a study recently which said that they would, you know, that parents don't want their kids, if they're Democrats, they don't want their kids dating Republicans.
Yeah.
I mean, I thought we were already sort of well on the way to that sort of stovepiping.
We absolutely were, but social media sped everything up. It sped up both polarization. It sped up anxiety and depression, unfortunately. So a lot of trends that we saw coming. I wrote a book called Freedom from Speech in 2014, thinking like, okay, this polarization thing's about to get much worse in 10 years. And, you know, by the next year, I was shocked at how bad it already got.
Okay, well, how much blame for the current situation should we put on parents for all this? Because, you know, the parents are... You know, they've gone from, you know, being overly indulgent to, what was it, the helicopter parents, and now they're, you know, motor mower parents or lawnmower parents, right. So they clear everything in front of them.
I say this as a parent. I know we get a lot of blame ourselves, but, you know, honestly, like, a lot of people want to blame the students themselves, but who's teaching them these things? Who's teaching them the catastrophizing? Who's teaching them the as we say in the book, the mental habits of anxious and depressed people, and then being surprised that they're anxious and depressed? And unfortunately, to a degree, it is to a degree parents, and particularly the kind of parents who send their kids to some of these elite schools.
So the parents, there's a wider issue, I think, isn't it? Because it's parents don't want to tell their kids anything bad. You know, it's like every child wins a prize, even if they suck.
Well, I think there's an emperor's new clothes problem going on here. I think actually a lot of parents know that the elimination of free time, crowding out free play, some of this kind of like life or death if you don't get into Princeton kind of attitude, I think a lot of parents know it's unhealthy and they know it's going to lead to something bad downstream, but I don't know if they know yet that other parents are thinking that too. And what we hope this book will do is tell parents all over the, you know, all over the country and across the pond that you're not alone, that other parents are saying that we've sensed we've done something wrong and we think we can fix it.
Time for a bit of a course correction. One of the criticisms, and there's not a lot of criticism in this book, but I will put this to you. You come to the conclusion that, you know, all of this protectionism on college campuses is sort of leading to this increased level of anxiety and depression. But aren't there plenty of other factors out there which could be responsible? And one of the examples that is given is massive student debt in the U.S. standing at $1.5 trillion. That seems like a pretty good reason to be depressed and anxious.
Yeah, and that's something that I originally... I talk about debt all the time, and the fact it didn't make it into the final copy of the book when someone brought up that criticism, like, you're totally right, debt is a big factor.
That sucks.
but we do talk about bureaucracy, and we do talk about, you know, how the swelling of the campus bureaucracy has made things worse. So I always make the point that a less expensive version, more stripped down, more rigorous version of education could also be less stress-inducing, but also, you know, freer at the same time.
Okay. From everything I've managed to read about the book so far, it's great. And congratulations. And
thanks.
Have a great time tonight.
Thanks so much for having me.
Pleasure.